I am delighted to introduce our keynote speaker today, author Manil Suri. Mr. Suri was born in Mumbai and is a professor of mathematics and affiliate professor of Asian Studies at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. His works of fiction have won several awards and have been translated into 27 languages. He is the author of The Death of Vishnu, The Age of Shiva, and The City of Devi. The City of Devi was nominated for the 2014 Lambda Literary Awards for Gay Fiction and won the Bisexual Book Awards for Best Bisexual Fiction. In his writings, Manil Suri reinterprets Hindu mythology, and he strives to change attitudes toward the LGBTQ community in India. It is with a great enthusiasm that I bring him to the podium. Thank you.
Take that. I'm trying to work this with some technology, so let's see how that goes. But it's wonderful to be here, and it's neat to hear, to see in the little brochure the reference to WordsOut, and of course Mark Ozzelli just mentioned that he was a member, and I was as well, and we used to meet at MLK Library, and before that at the Gay Community Center, the old Gay Community Center. So it was very formative to have a space to meet, and just the, you know, what the previous speaker was talking about, the community of having people to talk with and really bounce ideas off, bounce writing off. And I get asked a lot of questions, a lot of times, like, what should I do? I want to be a writer. And I think, especially in the beginning, having that community is extremely important. You just, you know, I mean, you often, like, when I've been in several writing groups, and many of them, all the writers, they were much better writers than I was, because they were going to schools and so on. And so I learned a lot, because I haven't had any formal training. So I would encourage people who are interested in writing to really, you know, take heed of that advice. That's great advice. I'm gonna talk a little bit about my book. And after my formal presentation, just chat about, you know, the whole, any questions that people might have, my own experiences with things. I actually started writing, you know, when I'm as Edgardo said, I actually teach, and so writing was completely a hobby for me. It was something that I would write a story maybe once every couple of years, so it wasn't much at all. And I think for me, the best thing about writing was it really got me to meet people that I would have never met. Like, okay, the math world is pretty closed, and so you talk with other mathematicians, and you know, they get very suspicious if you're doing anything else. Yeah. In fact, one of my favorite stories is that I was a new assistant professor, and I was at a talk. Someone came and gave a talk to us, and this guy was a famous bridge player in addition to being a great mathematician. And after that, this person came to me. He was a senior member of our department, and he said, "You know, that was a terrible talk." And I said, "Why do you say that? You know, he's not even in your field. You're in statistics. That was in differential equations." And this guy said, this senior professor said, "Oh, he plays bridge, he goes to national tournaments, he must spend too much time doing that, so he can't possibly be a good mathematician. You know, that you're doing something else." So at that moment I knew if I wanted to write, I'm going to keep silent about it since I wanted tenure, so that's what I did. So I'm going to start just by giving you the absolute beginning of this book. Actually, maybe I should start with some, let's see if I can summon up this. You know, I spend a lot of, it's been really fun doing some of these PowerPoint things. I do them for classes, and I said, well, why don't I do this for my book presentation too? So there's actually sound effects too. Oh, that's actually too low, so let's see how I can turn it up. I think it's just this thing over here that's too low. I just need to turn it up from here. Wait, let me just. No, it's right here. It's this thing that's too low.
And now, of course, it's going to be too high when I do this, and you're going to be all scared. But let's see how that is. Okay, that's better.
There's some explosions, so I must warn you.
So that's the title of my book, and I think what I'll do is I will do a couple of these. Okay, that's the special effects. So please, okay. So that's the hardcover. But let me read you the beginning of this book. 4 days before the bomb that is supposed to obliterate and kill us all, I stand in the ruins of Crawford Market, haggling with the lone remaining fruit seller over the price of the pomegranate in my hand. Is 500 rupees not an outrageous price already? Why won't you sell it to me for 500? Look at what's happening around you, Mamesahib. Do you think the orchards are overflowing with pomegranates? Do you think the lorries are driving into Mumbai every day and filling the markets with fruit? I'm only asking for 1,000 because it's you, Mamesahib. But even 3 times that won't be too much for this last piece, which really was the best wine in the pile to begin with. The fruitwala has a point. Supply and demand, he has me where he wants. This much I know, I must have the pomegranate before I begin my quest. Some instinct deep inside insists it's my best shot. But what's tied into the folds of the silk dupatta around my neck is a few hundred less than the fruitwala wants. But yeah, listen, I try once more. They're dropping the atom bomb this week. Atom bomb, you understand? Not some firecracker that's demolished the market around you. On Bombay, Mumbai, whatever you call it, the city's going to be finished. What would you do even if you did manage to squeeze out the extra money from someone? Take it to heaven with you? And what if nobody else came to your store? Most of the city has fled, you know. Is this what you want to happen to your fruit? I nudge a tangerine with my foot and it crumbles into ash. But the fruitwala is adamant. He won't sell for less. It's all up to Devi Ma's grace, he says. She's the city's patron goddess after all. Now that she's appeared in our midst, perhaps she'll save us, who knows. But even if she doesn't, even if she only lets me hold the money for 10 minutes, at least I'll have it for that much time. At least I'll die with an offering for her in my hand. So that's Sarita, and those are the eyes that you saw, and she's the heroine of this book. And what's happened is that the city, which is Mumbai, is under attack in some ways, and Sarita's there's this threat of this war with Pakistan going on. There's a threat of nuclear terrorism. So people have fled out of the city, and the remaining city has kind of divided into Hindu and Muslim factions. And Sarita is looking for her husband, Karun. If anyone is a Bollywood aficionado, you might recognize some of these eyes, because I just cut out people's faces and put them in. That's actually the guy from Slumdog Millionaire. So anyway, he's playing Karun in my film version of this book, and he's disappeared. It's been about 2 weeks, he's gone, and she doesn't know where he is. The last time she talked to him, he was somewhere north. And the city, incidentally, if you look at it, Bombay is very, it's very north-south. It used to be a bunch of islands, and people actually filled them in. And so Sarita is way at the bottom, at the lowermost tip, and Karun was last heard from up here. And so Sarita has to make her way up there. And of course, all sorts of transport has disappeared. There's nothing there. So the city is essentially a maze for her, and she has to find this husband of hers who's disappeared. And pomegranate, you've already heard of, so there's, you know, a bunch of things. And the pomegranate was interesting because I put it in the beginning, and then I said, what am I going to do with this pomegranate? Sarita actually gets the pomegranate and keeps kind of holding it and, you know, finally figured out what to do with it, but towards the end. There's something called Marmite. Has anyone here had Marmite? Okay, and you're still alive. That's good to hear. So this is one of the most vile substances known to man. It's basically hydrolyzed yeast protein. Is that what it is? I grew up in Bombay, and being a former British colony, we had to eat Marmite. So And it was fine there, but this is nasty stuff. You should try it just to see how bad it is. So anyway, the Marmite is very important. It's another kind of clue in this whole book. That was my big special effect. That's something called the Super Devi. And maybe I'll read you a tiny little bit from that. So the Super Devi is just a, well, here. Super Devi released that summer, deluging even non-movie people like us with its hype. The most expensive Indian film ever made, thanks to the backing of both Hollywood and the Indian mafia. Lata Mangeshkar teams up for her techno comeback with Lady Gaga, who my sister Uma said was a famous pop star. Their title duet rockets to the top of charts worldwide. And up in the sky, a bird, a jet, no, Super Devi herself, zooming overhead behind a prop plane as we sat and tried to ignore her on the beach at Chapati. Supposedly, the script borrowed extensively from Slumdog Millionaire and Superman, films which neither of us had seen, in telling the story of a young girl from the Mumbai slums with the power to assume different avatars of Devi to fight crime. Uma kept herding us to McDonald's, which was giving away all 9 incarnations from the movie as collectible action figures. Throughout India and parts of England and New Jersey, free with food purchases, vegetarian only so as not to upset Hindu sentiments. She collected 8 of the figures, turning off the light at home to show us how they glowed in the dark, just like Super Devi. Despite foisting dozens of Makalu Tikki sandwiches on us, however, she never managed to acquire the elusive Kali incarnation, toting her AK-47 from the final battle scene. So the Devi is, of course, the mother goddess, and that's actually whom the city is named after. Mumbai is, you know, Mumba Devi. It's actually, Mumba means mother in Marathi. And this movie has taken the world by storm. But in India, it's also had a sort of bad effect where, people, right-wing politicians have been saying that the Super Devi's message is to rid the country of all minorities. And so, especially in the villages, people have been stoked up with this anti-Muslim rhetoric. And so when things start to go wrong, this is what really causes a lot of the problems. But anyway, going along, there's also another ingredient, and that's Shamu the elephant. And the reason he's here is because someone told me that every good Indian book has to have an elephant. And I was remiss with my first 2 books, so I had to put him in. And then there's the most interesting aspect, and that is Jazz. Jazz is a gay Muslim character, and Sarita meets him on her, you know, as she's looking for her husband. And the city is very different for Jazz. For Jazz, it's more like a playground. He's always looking for action in Mumbai. And a lot of the action that, I mean, he kind of tags along with Sarita, and she doesn't really know what's going on, why he's there. So I'm going to read you a little section of Jazz, which is kind of my favorite section. When this book first came out, I went to India for the opening and for the release, and the first place that I read at was Calcutta, which is now called Kolkata, and there was a book festival there, and I was told, you know, well, this is a very conservative city. Whatever you do, don't read out one of the Jazz sections, especially not any of the gay sex scenes. And so naturally, that's exactly what I did. And it was interesting because there were about 3 people who walked out, which is great, you know. I mean, you want that. But then everybody else just sat there, you know. It was like I was kind of disappointed. The people didn't faint and nothing happened, you know. So it was interesting though, because after that, you heard that I teach at UMBC, and after that, I came back to the U.S. and I gave a talk at UMBC, and I had all my students there from the math classes that I teach. And the president was there, and all these people were there, and I debated for a long time, should I read this section or not? And then I said, I'm not going to read it. And then when I got there, I said, okay, I have to read this. So I did read it, and that was fun too, in a different way. So let me read you this section. And what Jazz's story is that his parents are Muslim scholars, and they've come up with a new theory of Islam. And so this book has been a big bestseller, and they've been going from country to country, giving talks and visiting universities. And Jazz has been sort of, you know, just been taken from place to place. And he's having a lot of emotional problems. And of course, the main thing is he's gay and he doesn't realize that. So on his 15th birthday or something, he takes a pin and pierces his tongue and blows it out on his birthday cake. And, you know, just it's a very gory scene, but you don't see it. So here's what happens after that. That finally got their attention. My parents' solution was to move once more, to Mother India this time, which would unscramble my identity, fill my heart with pride in who I was, where I came from. That's how the young and still impressionable Jazz found himself sitting in the green-walled annex to the Baikula Mosque in Bombay, fitted with a skullcap and equipped with a Quran. Each evening, as the adults prayed upstairs, I stared at the paint peeling off the benches, trying to tune out the hadiths being explained by the imam. Could I escape again by piercing some other body part? Fortunately, my cousin Rahim, who attended the same class, had alternative plans for my edification. My parents, ever pressed for time, arranged for me to spend the evenings at his home afterwards. At 16, Rahim not only exceeded me in age, but also in girth. I experienced his weight firsthand each time he sat on me at the end of our wrestling bouts. He insisted we strip down to our underwear, like sumo wrestlers, his sweat marked by body, smelling of whatever spice lingered most dominantly from lunch. Rahim's mother had died a decade ago, and his father worked late, so we didn't have to worry about anyone supervising us. Soon we were undressing completely and wrestling in the buff. I'm not sure if my technique improved or if Rahim simply let me, but I started ending up more often on top than not. My thighs straddling his hips, my seat pressed into his crotch, even though I left his hands free, he never pushed me off. One evening, I had the bright idea of slapping him in the face with my penis as we horsed around. He looked at me strangely, then leaned forward and took me in his mouth. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, survivors of the coming October 19th Holocaust or future alien voyagers, this is where my journey takes its most dramatic turn. The before and after, the BC and the CE, the divine revelation that swept away all my baggage from the past. Suddenly I didn't feel hopeless. Suddenly I found myself in control. Suddenly the answers to all my questions popped and burst like fireworks. My identity flashed on, my confidence powered up, the path to my fulfillment in life blazed in the sun. Over the next few weeks, Rahim and I poked and probed and plumbed. We matched appendages to orifices in every combination that sprang to our fevered minds. Dispensing with the wrestling, we dove directly each evening into racking up the notches on the bedpost, not to mention the sofa, the dining table, the kitchen stool, even the telephone stand before it broke. The arduousness of some of our experiments eased appreciably when we discovered the lubrication properties of pantry ingredients. Jam was too sticky. Butter worked better than mayonnaise, but nothing rivaled the glissance of pure ghee. My parents couldn't stop beaming. How eagerly I trotted off to class every evening, how well their mosque experiment seemed to be working. They even published a paper on this. Therapeutic self-affirmative effects of religious instruction on troubled youth soon after. The fact that I'd begun paying attention to my physique was an added bonus. Healthy mind, healthy body, just like the Quran says, my father remarked. Each morning he saw me performing calisthenics. In reality, roles had begun to emerge in my after-curricular activity. Clearly, I was the boinker, Rahim, the eternal boinky. If I wanted to fit my emerging self-image, it behooved me to start pumping up. So that's Jazz, and Jazz is someone that was just a lot of fun to write about. So this book I started way back. I don't even want to tell you when I started it. But after a few years, I had all these ingredients gathered up, and they were suddenly what I knew is I had to just put them all together and write the last one third, and then the book would be done. And these strands just kept waving in front of my face, and I could not put them together. And, you know, the weeks went by, the months went by, the years went by, and I just couldn't do it. And finally, what I decided was, hey, I'm a mathematician, so I should look at this problem very logically, very methodically. And so I started writing all these plot points. These are all actual notes of, okay, what I started doing was I started making these decision trees, which you've probably seen, you know, like if you've actually played chess, you've probably seen it for chess. You know, okay, white moves, white can get to A, and then black can do this, this, or this. And you sort of optimize, you figure out all possible ways of doing it. And that's what I started doing, and I started making these endless notes. And the problem was that whatever I tried, you know, the final thing was always either too trite or wasn't consistent or I just didn't believe it. And so everything that I tried, nothing worked. And I finally realized what this was telling me. I finally realized that what I had done was come up with a mathematical proof to show that the novel could not be written. And this was great. I said, okay, my work is done both as a mathematician and as a writer, so I can go off and write something else. And I actually put this book aside, and I started a different book. And in fact, this is something I sent my agent. I said, okay, this is the end of this novel. It's going to take me a lot more years. And she, not being a mathematician, did not appreciate my proof. So she said, can I read it? I'll see if there's anything salvageable. So then I started playing around with it and fixing things, you know, before I sent it to her. And that's when something really amazing appeared. And I had three characters, and they started coming together. And so what I noticed was I had these three characters, and for all these years, I've been writing this series of three books which take the three main characters from Hindu mythology, and there's a book named after each one of them. And these characters actually corresponded to these gods. Sarita was very much like the mother goddess. Jazz was a lot like Vishnu, who's always full of energy, always doing things. And Karun was like Shiva, that he was actually withdrawing from the world. And, you know, he fit that mold. And so once I saw that, I realized that what I had to do was, first of all, there were other triptychs in this book, like India, China, and Pakistan form an interesting triangle there. There were other things, too, that I won't get into. But what I realized is that I really had to bring all these three characters together. And once I was able to do that, I was able to really figure out how to proceed and actually finish the book. So that was an interesting thing. I want to just tie in one last thing, and that is what Edgardo said about tying this to Hindu mythology. One of the really interesting things is that, you know, there's this, as I said, there's these three main gods. Shiva is the, well, Vishnu is the preserver. He keeps things running. Shiva is the destroyer. He also withdraws from the universe, and that's why things don't work out. And Devi is, as I said, the mother goddess. Shiva and Vishnu have a very interesting mythology to them. As I said, Shiva is the kind of, he's the more internalized god. But if you look at typical architecture with Shiva, the middle part is his kind of ascetic image. But if you look at the two other sides, one is feminine and one is masculine. So he actually combines these two inside himself. And here you actually see that half his body, the right half, is feminine and the left half is masculine. So you actually see that in this relief. This is actually Vishnu. Vishnu actually has a very interesting mythology where he, in a famous myth, he actually comes to Earth because Shiva is withdrawing. So Vishnu takes the form of a beautiful woman and he seduces Shiva. And then Shiva forgets about his own wife and runs after him, and they actually have a child. And this is actually Shiva and Vishnu combined. So one side is Shiva and the other side is Vishnu. So you have all this merging of gender and you know, these two deities. So that was one of the interesting things that I played with in this book. And one of the things that happened after that was that I think if you have been reading about what's been happening in India, last December, Section 377, which was the law that made sodomy illegal, but which had been lifted, was reinstated by the Supreme Court. So once again, homosexual conduct is now illegal in India. And for a while, people said, well, this is just theoretical, nothing's going to actually happen. But then there have been cases where people have been, you know, raped by the police, they've been brutalized in different ways. You know, it's not a huge thing, but everything has gone underground again. So it was very interesting to see that this book came out at the same time. It came out last year in January when things were really fine, and then suddenly by December everything had changed. So that's one of the big things in India, what's going to happen. And not just in India, but we know several other countries which are much worse off. So anyway, I'll stop there with this final special effect. Okay, so that's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We're going to be leading into a break, but we'll take this time now for some question and answers. And we'd like to begin. Who would like to start?
Do you know the reception of your book changed as the law went into place and the effects of it? Or is it existing?
Yeah, there's nothing like, you know, people are, again, in India things are, you anytime you have something, you also have its opposite. So it's not like suddenly people said, let's ban this book. Although it would be great if it were banned, you know. My God, that would be wonderful. But no, that's not happened. So, and it's been interesting. You know, I've been writing things and so on. But, like, it's just weird. One of these things is that, okay, everyone knows this law is there, but then everyone flouts it. But there's also this sense of unease. So it's not clear how things are going to change. Now, of course, there's a more right-wing government who are more religiously tied. So I don't know what's going to happen. So stay tuned.
Since you had a lot of problem putting it all together, mm-hmm. as you described the whole
right.
history of putting the book together, I was just wondering... in the book that you read, I mean, I didn't find anything that, and I'm not an LGBTQ. I would like to find out what Q is anyway. Did it have, and you said you gave a opening or release in Bombay. What kind of people showed up, by the way, just curious?
Oh, it was the usual kind of literary crowd. Actually, when I grew up, I was in this small apartment with three other families, and we had one room, and you know there were three Muslim families that lived with us, and we were the only Hindu family. And my neighbors, who was right next door, whom I grew up with, he came to the opening, and I guess he didn't really know that I was gay, so he you know listened to me say this, and he was fine with it. So I mean that's one of the things in India. Like if you meet most people, they're fine with it, but then there are these books on the laws, there are these laws on the books, which are from the time of the British. If you look at certain other countries like Singapore, Malaysia, and their five other countries, they also have a Section 377. It's called 377 there too, because you know they just took those laws and just put them in their constitution. So the same law and the same language exists in all these other places. So we have the British to thank for that.
When writing about, Vedic philosophy or the nature of religion, do you utilize your own personal beliefs or common beliefs that might be associated with a particular area in India, for example?
So I grew up culturally Hindu, but not theoretically in the sense that we didn't have Sunday school, so I didn't know anything about mythology. And so when the first book, when I started writing it, it was called The Death of Vishnu because there was an actual man named Vishnu that I knew who died. And then the writing instructor said, hey, you need to tie that to the god Vishnu You can't call a main character Vishnu and then just not have anything, because that's what people will be thinking about. And I kind of argued. I said, wait a minute, everyone in India is named after some god or the other. So why are you picking on me? So, but then it made a lot of sense. And that's when I really started looking into religion, looking into the Bhagavad Gita, looking into the Quran as well, and basically reading up a lot of that. So it was through that. So I would say it's not so much personal. But then, you know, in the course of that first book, like some of these things, I'm very much an atheist, but some of these things have a very spiritual side to them. So I really got immersed into that. So that's when I kind of made it my own, and then maybe that helped the writing as well for the first book.
I'm new to your writing, but I have just started the Devi book, and I have to say that I felt that your combining of the three gods and the Pakistan, China, and India together is a bit genius. You know, I just went, oh my gosh, he put all this together, and I just thought, well, this is really somebody I want to read and read all of his books as well.
Well, thank you.
I lived 3 years in Mumbai, so it feels like home almost to read the book. But I'd also have to ask you, what is your native place? Are you from Mumbai?
Yes.
And you grew up there, and your family is from Mumbai as well?
My family, actually, you'd have to read the second book for that. So, because in the first book, you know, the first book was about, actually, this man lived in the same building. So I actually grew up in Mumbai. As I said, it was like one room in a big apartment with three Muslim families. So, you know, the Hindu-Muslim thing is a big thing in India. So that really figured a lot in that book. And this man actually died while I was visiting India. And so I said, I have to write something. I didn't really know him, but that's the impetus for the first book. So for the second book, like, I used everything I knew about Mumbai in that first book. Well, what's a writer to do when you've used up everything? Well, you start stealing from your parents' story. So that's what I did in the second book. And my parents had a very interesting background. They actually were born in what is now Pakistan. They were born in Rawalpindi. And that's where they got married. And they, in fact, got married on 10th July, 1947. And that's a very kind of iffy date, because on August 15th, 1947, the country was split apart, and it became Pakistan and India. And so, like many Hindus, they had to flee. So they didn't even open their wedding presents, nothing. They just had to run. And, you know, that was a very traumatic time for the country, because like 500,000 people died. 10 million people were displaced. So anyway, that's their background. And they ended up coming to Mumbai. But it's not really about them. That's the thing. When you start writing something and you say, okay, I have all this good stuff. And when you put it on the paper, it just says, okay, so they didn't open their wedding presents. So what? You know, it's like, it just doesn't remain as dramatic. So I actually scrapped writing about them and just used that as a sort of little background. But the story is really about, you know, this family that comes to India and what happens after that. So anyway, long answer.
I just have to say, it all seems to be working very well in the book.
Well,
obviously for a lot of people as well. So
well, thank you.
Appreciate your efforts.
Thank you. And by the way, I didn't bring books here, but if anyone needs a book signed, you know, Facebook, contact me on Facebook, and I'll come and you can buy it at Politics and Prose, and I'll come there and sign it. So anyway. Just throwing out that little plug, but.
Hi. Something that we talk about a lot is just representation and of seeing people who might look like you. So I was wondering if there's been any instances in which young LGBT people who are either Indian descent, Hindu, have come up to you and said, you know, this is really cool, this is someone like me, or someone who I can sort of explain to my parents or to my friends too, that sort of relate to our culture?
Mm-hmm. No, that's a great question. And I have had people at readings tell me things like that. There was one person in Boston especially who was from Pakistan, and he said that the Muslim character here really struck a chord in him, just because like some things were expressed there that he hadn't been able to articulate. And then through Facebook, that's been really good, because people have been contacting me, and just, you know, people out of the blue. And I try to carry out a conversation. A lot of people will be in India, and things are opening up. There's a nice kind of network on the web that you can actually meet people, but it's still tough. So it's like someone will contact me, and then I'll say, yes, how are you doing? Do you have a support system? And then I won't hear back from them. And then maybe a few months later, something will happen, and they might contact me again. So that's been very interesting, having this kind of communication open up. But it's like I have seen people who've stories are all so different. Like in this country, for instance, a lot of Indians who come here become extra conservative, and so they've come out of their motherland, so they're in this new milieu, and so they really dig in just to hold on to their culture. So then their kids, if their kids happen to be LGBT and the Q stands for queer, then they have to deal with a lot. So it's, and again, there are groups open for them. And you know, people, I have to say one other thing. There's an Asian American writers workshop in New York, and they had a festival last year in Brooklyn. And so I read out this, and there were two kids there whose parents are Bori Muslim. And I don't know if anyone knows what Bori Muslim is. It's not a sect exactly, but a group, subgroup of Muslims. But if you saw them, you would say, my God, these two guys are really very religious. They had the beards and they had the little caps and everything. They were really dressed perfectly, like very religiously. But then they told me, hey, they're just doing it to satisfy their parents. And they're both gay, and they go on, they try to go on parties and all, and it's very hard for them to manage because they live at home. So there's a lot of scope for a lot of different subgroups, culturally different groups that need a lot of support, even in this country. So you can imagine what it must be like in a place like India, where things are much more hidden and much more underground. It's much harder.
I'm also writing a book where the characters follow religion, which was one that I wasn't exposed and raised with. When do you feel, when you're doing the research on a religion, that you have enough of it so that your characters are honest mm-hmm. with their what they say, what they express, and what they do?
Well, I guess I haven't exactly been in the position that you might be in the sense that I've, since I grew up with Muslims and with Hindus, I've written about those two religions, so I can actually check and make sure that they jibe with my own experiences. In terms of actually doing any kind of research,